That's our supply tent at the back. That's where we burned our garbage. Now that rock at the back, it was like a V-pit. That rock at the back that you just saw was important later on when the polar bear arrived in our camp. But in the meantime, for something to do, I don't remember where we got the wood, but we managed to get it. We built ourselves a little picket fence. There's the shot of the sun. You'll see an explosion. There it is. There were hundreds of little streams running down the side of the mountain, and they blasted a hole for us for our drinking water so we could catch it. There's the lake I mentioned earlier had Arctic char in it, and we went fishing, and there's an Arctic char that we caught. We actually brought it back, filleted it, cooked it, and had a nice meal. Again, Roy and I clowning around. He's fishing in a bucket, and I guess I'm attempting to shoot the fish. The sign up there says, Godet and Ray Rest Home. You can see now the ice is starting to break up. This would be probably about the end of June. Snow was pretty well gone from the land. Just pockets of it here and there. The pilots that flew in here were sometimes pretty amazing. Landing through fog. There's a shot of a fox, again just to show that there's wildlife. Pretty hard to see, but he scrummaged around in our garbage, where we kept our garbage. In fact, one time we got some fresh eggs from the maintenance camp cook. We brought them up. We had a little cave with still some ice in it. We put the eggs in there, and lo and behold, the fox got into the eggs, and the next day when we went to have our fresh eggs for breakfast, they were all gone. There's an iceberg, and this is, I guess, would be the middle to the end of July. Ice is all gone from the water, and the occasional berg is floating around, occasional chunk of ice. Temperature would be low 70s Fahrenheit. Gorgeous. A lot prettier when the snow is gone. Come the 1st of September, we had a snowstorm. Took down our communications towers and covered everything with a blanket of snow. We had a heck of a time erecting temporary towers so that we could resume communications with our main camp. So summer was pretty short-lived. One morning I was going out for a constitutional, and I heard a noise behind me. There's the generator, snow covered, kept a tarp on top of it, and our communications, some of our communication stuff is pretty badly twisted. At any rate, one morning I was going out for my constitutional and I heard a noise behind me, and I turned around and there was a polar bear. There he is. So I jumped on that piece of rock that I explained earlier where our garbage pit was, and he came up to me, and he was so close I could probably reach out and I could have whopped him on the nose, but he couldn't jump across or didn't want to jump across that crevice, so I felt pretty safe. At that time my partner, who was Charlie, Roy had to go down to Frobisher with an emergency appendicitis, so the company flew in another guy to keep me company. I was by myself for about a week. He had a pin in his leg, and he sure hustled out of the tent after I yelled at him. And so we vacated our camp right away, our hut, and went down below. Didn't want to stick around with the polar bear roaming loose. And that just about did it anyways for the, we're getting pretty close to the end of our stint. These are the huts that the maintenance camp boys live in. They're actually quite nice inside. And these are the types of vehicles that they use to get around, mostly to go up to the Dew Line station and back. Almost like a Jeep. There's the plane coming in to take us home. It's a Canso. They call it a Canso. It's able to land on water. Twin engine. They had a load of Eskimos on board, and what they did is they walked up the side of the mountain, grabbed our stuff, and hand-carried it all down to the aircraft. A final, almost farewell shot of the fellows we sort of chummed around with when we were at the maintenance camp. And here's a shot of from the aircraft as after we were airborne. The castle has a compartment right at the front, and that's where I sat for the trip home, or home back to our main camp. So the pilots were above me and behind me. A shot of the engine. And there's the runway coming in at Fox, as we called it, Fox, Maine. And that's about the end of this story. After we landed, we hopped a plane, went to Montjoly, Quebec, and then a train back to Toronto. I see a shot of the B-17. There it is. It's coming up. That's the plane we used for mapping the island. And that's it. The end of my adventure. Take off to the great white north. Take off. It's a beauty way to go. Take off to the great white north.
Hey, Jose.
Yeah, what?
Yeah, listen to this. It's coming. You know what it is?
What?
It's a drum solo.
Okay, everyone, like, this is me on the drums,
Get out. It is not.
It is so.
Stop lying, will you?
Take off, eh?